Hello there, welcome to Palm Sunday at St. Paul Presbyterian. Today we join the joyful and desperate crowds as they cry out, Hosanna, meaning God save us. As Jesus rides into Jerusalem, like that first crowd, we too are asking Jesus to save us, though we realize that our salvation may perhaps look different than we expect. Hey, if you are a first-time guest with us, I would invite you to let us know who you are by filling out a digital connection card that you'll find linked to online. Now, three quick announcements today. The first is that everyone, whether you're in the choir or not, is invited to join us at church today after worship to sing some Easter hymns that we will use for our online Easter service. Second is to invite you to our online Maundy Thursday service this Thursday, April 1st at 7 o'clock p.m. on YouTube and Facebook. Again, this is online only. Finally, these words, Ollie, Ollie, oxen free! Come out, wherever you are. Next Sunday is Easter. And we are inviting all who are able to join us again for in-person worship. Unless it's just pouring rain outside, we will gather outside for our opening and for the closing of the service to sing. I mean to really sing our Easter praise. And now, as we begin our service, I invite you to slow down and to take a few deep breaths to remember why it is that we are here and to invite the presence of the unhurried, the unpanicked God into our lives. Let us continue in worship as we hear the story of the first Palm Sunday.
When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples to them, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, the Lord needs them, and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Now repeat after me and start waving those branches. Hosanna to the Son of David." And let the people say, "Hosanna to the Son of David." And let the people say, "Blessed is he who comes. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. In the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus of Nazareth from Galilee."
Thank you. seen that the stories of Jesus' healing ministry are filled with words and deeds. When he rides into Jerusalem, the people had hopes he would heal the oppressive system they were living under. We know that his healing was not confined to that moment in history, but offers a new way of life that has made a case for compassion for all, especially the least, ever since. As we head into the events of Holy Week, we begin to see that our ability to forgive others and ourselves is the foundation that can transform infirmities and allow us to move on. We integrate our beliefs and actions for the health of the whole. The parade of compassionate power we celebrate today is underscored by another healing story of transformation, symbolizing our ability to fuel our movement of recovery. We glorify God for beautiful words and works of wholeness and share that treasured beauty with others. We know there will still be pain, but we also know love will win.
Approach confession each week in Lent in such a way that we lay bare the brokenness in order to begin the process of healing. Along the way, we have acknowledged our need to restore our own holy vessels while attending to our role in the healing of the community and the world. The work of healing will continue as we integrate all we have learned with all that we will do moving forward. For now, we remember how hard it is to move from thinking to doing. Let us pray. Forgiving God, we have opened ourselves to healing, and sometimes it's easier to pray nice prayers than to do the hard work of putting into action what needs to happen. Help us remember the sacred nature of the holy vessels that we are, fragile and susceptible to shattering, and yet capable of transformation. Help us to see ourselves as you see us. Help us to believe in our ability to change and heal as you believe in us. Help us, healer, show us our strength, forgive our inertia, move us to move one step at a time toward greater care. In this silence, we sense and acknowledge our yearning for wholeness. I invite you to return to that warm glow of light that lives deep within you once again. It may already be burning, bright with the excitement of the parade, the presence of Jesus leading us on. But if you are struggling or have struggled in this season of recovery to feel this warmth of assurance within you, do not despair. You are not the one who has to create the light. It just is. And it is a pilot light that never goes out. At some point in your life, you will begin to notice it returning to your awareness. Know this. You are never alone in the struggle, no matter what. Jesus is on the journey with us. Life's parade is not just passing you by. You are part of this body of Christ, a community seeking healing for you, for me, for all. Take a deep breath in. Let this truth fill you and breathe out with the relief of assurance. Now I invite you to imagine the warmth that surrounds you, extending to those who may be next to you in close proximity. Imagine it extending beyond the walls to your neighborhood, to the St. Paul community, to the wider community. See God's love spread just like the rising sun. Let it expand to all the world. Let this be our peace. Amen. If you've not already, I invite you to open your eyes. The peace of Christ is with you and also with you.
We know only too well that what we are doing is nothing more than a drop in the ocean. But if that drop were not there, the ocean would be missing something. Mother Teresa. Act as if what you do makes a difference. It does. William James. You can't make yourself feel positive, but you can choose how to act, and if you choose right, it builds your confidence. Julian Smith.
We are in the sixth and the final service in our Holy Vessels Lenten series. Our text today is Matthew chapter 9, verses 1 through 8. And after getting into a boat, Jesus crossed the sea and came to his own town. And just then, some people were carrying a paralyzed man lying on a bed. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Take heart, son, your sins are forgiven." Then some of the scribes said to themselves, "This man is blaspheming." But Jesus, perceiving their thoughts, said, "Why do you think evil in your hearts? For which is easier to say, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Stand up and walk'? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he then said to the paralytic, "Stand up, take your bed, and go to your home." And he stood up, and he went to his home. When the crowd saw it, they were filled with awe, and they glorified God, who had given such authority to human beings. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, perhaps the most surprising thing in our healing story today is that Jesus handles a case of paralysis by offering forgiveness of sins. I mean, imagine traveling all the way to the Mayo Clinic with your wheelchair-bound spouse only to have the doctor refer you to a local pastor. It just doesn't seem to make any sense, does it? If I were the paralyzed man or his friends, I would probably ask to see Jesus' rabbinical certificate or at least request bus money to go home. Like the crowd on Palm Sunday, the man and his friends came to Jesus crying out, saying, "Hosanna, God save us." But Jesus will disappoint both groups, at least at first. As soon as they learn that his primary concern isn't political salvation or physical healing, but the forgiveness of sins. Yet it gets you wondering, doesn't it? Could those two be connected? The problem, Bible scholar Thomas Long tells us, is that our view of sin is just too narrow. To many of us, Long says, sin is a word that simply describes the naughty things that people have done, their bad actions or their misdeeds. But sin, according to the Bible, is much larger than naughty stuff. It is a power, says Long, that captures us, that infects society, that pollutes nature, that enslaves the human heart, and destroys human life. Sinning, then, is much more than somehow stepping over a mutual moral line. To sin, rather, is to be captivated by the larger forces that oppose God and join them in doing their bidding. Sinning is like being a prisoner of war who, through fear and weakness, collaborates with the enemy. Sin is a force of evil that enslaves and destroys human life. Sin employs many devices and servants. Chaos, the demonic, hatred, systemic oppression, death, and in our story, illness. The will of God, Long says, is for people to have life and to have it abundantly. John 10:10, right? Disease and death, then, are agents of rebellion against God, shock troops under the command of the power of sin. Sin, in this view, isn't just something that happens to a person. Rather, it happens to all of creation. And so the Apostle Paul says in Romans 8:21, the whole of creation is in bondage to decay, to sin. In other words, all of creation is sick. There is a cancer in the marrow of the world. So what Jesus is doing in Matthew chapter 8 is far more profound than simply healing a paralytic. What he is saving us from is far more important than political or physical illness. He is saving us from the underlying force that fuels all political, emotional, environmental, and physical disease. He is saving us from sin itself. Curing a paralyzed limb, says Long, is like holding back a wave. Eradicating the power of sin is like sweeping back the entire ocean. Jesus has already taken on physical illness and shown his powers as a healer of our holy vessels. We've seen that throughout this entire Lenten series. But now Jesus takes on a greater foe, sin itself. He has moved from the symptom to the source. Thanks be to God. Martin Luther rightly exclaims, "The entire kingdom of Christ is in the sentence, 'Your sins are forgiven.'" Through the forgiveness of sins made possible by Jesus' teaching, death and resurrection, humanity is set free from all that paralyzes it. To experience the forgiveness of sins is to become unstuck and freed to move again. Chris Simpson, for instance, a 38-year-old garbage man and former Marine, with the words "pure hate" tattooed across his knuckles, was consumed with hatred. After the loss of his first child, Simpson was full of anger and smoldering with hatred. The White Pride movement gave Simpson a place to direct his anger and frustration at people of other races. Things began to change, however, during a family trip to Walmart one day. One of his children looked down an aisle and then up at Simpson and said, "Daddy, you can't go down that aisle. There's an N blank down there." Simpson knew that he had to change. He had to change for his family. He had to change for himself. And so he began attending church. 1 month later, in April of 2012, he was baptized as a follower of Jesus Christ. "Any kind of burdens I carried before, I let them go," Simpson says. "There's no need to carry things that happened in the past. I forgave all of those who wronged me, and I ask forgiveness from those that I have wronged." His children, once picking up on Simpson's racism, now model his Christianity. When we accepted Christ It was like this whole house was transformed, Simpson said of his family. I'm just praying that this roller coaster ride keeps going up. Forgiveness of sins can change the world. It can change hatred to love, apathy to whole, to action, brokenness to holy wholeness. Do you believe that? It's not easy, despite stories like Chris's, not in our world, not during a pandemic, not after two more mass murders just days apart. By the way, I've been in that King Superstore in Boulder, Colorado. It's hard to have faith. Not after the alarming rise of white nationalism in our country and its broad acceptance, apparently. Not after the environmental statistics that I shared last week. Not after our very own children struggle to find hope for their future. It takes faith to believe in the power of forgiveness in a world as broken as ours. It takes faith. It doesn't take a lot of faith, just a mustard seed faith, as Jesus said. And yet sometimes we don't even have that. Sometimes it's hard to have any faith when life beats us down again and again and again. I have been there. And it's at times like that that we need to hear Jesus' words to the paralytic anew. Take heart, or take courage, as another translation renders it, my child. Take heart? I mean, what is this, a cruel joke? I mean, what basis does the paralytic have for courage in our story? What basis does he have for hope, for faith? It's the faith of his friends. His friends who took him to Jesus when he couldn't go himself. Often, Douglas Hare says, when our own faith is faltering, we must allow ourselves to be carried by the faith of others. Faith is a corporate activity, not simply a private exercise. When we cannot feel God's reality, we must lean on the perceptions of others. Indeed, sometimes in life, we find it easy to join the Palm Sunday crowd, to wave our palm branches and to shout our praises. At other times, we are dependent upon the praise and the prayers and the perceptions of others. Where do you find songs of praise in your life when your songs are stuck in your throat? Perhaps your children, your grandchildren, your friends, the gathered assembly of the people of God, the birds who for some unexplained reason sing their hearts out, even on rainy mornings. The flowers that are pushing their way through the cold earth. When you have no faith, look to the faith of the created order. Look to the faith of others. Seek out others, whether in person or by reading a good book written by a person of faith. Perhaps even reading the good book, written by men and women who were well acquainted with brokenness and discouragement, and yet who found faith. Faith like that is contagious. It's well known that discouragement can spread, but so can encouragement. Faith can spread. It is the good virus. When the Palm Sunday crowd saw Jesus ride into Jerusalem, they welcomed him into their hearts and they sang his praise. In like manner, when the crowds in Matthew 9 saw Jesus heal the paralytic, they too were filled with awe and they glorified God who had given such authority to human beings. Notice the plural, human beings. God just didn't give the authority to declare and to experience the forgiveness of sins to Jesus. He gave it to his authorized community and all in it, the church. So claim your inheritance, O you sons and daughters of the Most High God, and live into the freedom and the fellowship of the forgiven. May it be so. For we pray it in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, world without end. Amen.
In your love, make us whole. May we rest in your compassion.
Calm the lost, weary soul in the warmth of your love.
May your peace fill our hearts. May we know the love of Jesus. By your grace you console, make us holy.
Suffering.